Well, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you're viewing this from. I'm Steve Darling with Proactive, and welcome inside the Worldwide Broadcast Center in Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada, for another Proactive live stream. We're super excited to bring these companies to you to talk a little bit more about what they're doing, what they did last year, and of course, what's expected in 2021. We're back again with one of our favorites to be chatting with, and that's NexTech AR Solutions. Had an incredible year in 2020, really a building year, you might say, and are looking forward to 2021. So let's get right to it. And as we do that, I want to remind you that we always encourage your questions as well. There is a chat feature at the side. If you'd like to click on that, write a question within the chat, I'll be sure to mention those to the CEO as well. So again, let's get started and welcome in once again the Chief Administrative Officer for NexTech AR Solutions, Evan Gappelberg. And Evan, I'll ask you to turn your camera on. And there he is. Nice to see you, my friend. Happy New Year and welcome to 2021.
Thanks. Great to be back with you, Steve. Yeah, 2020, couldn't really get over 2020. Like, you know, trying to, that year was a year for the history books for sure.
Yeah, very much so. Before we get into what we want to talk about last year and what's ahead in 2021, we're also going to introduce you to one of your key hires that you made just towards the end of 2020. I want to talk about what's above your head, and I'm not talking about your hair. I'm actually talking about your new logo and new colors as well, fresh for 2021. So tell me about the redesign.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time in Q4 trying to come up with our new brand. Our new logo. I mean, the original logo was nice. We definitely feel attached to it. And it's how we started. But as we grew the business, as we grew our headcount, as we grew the company and the vision, we felt that we had kind of outgrown the original branding. And so we set off on this journey to create a new brand. And here it is. NexTech AR Solutions, new brand colors. That's actually an N that's also morphs into an infinity sign, which also morphs into almost anything. It's augmented reality driven company. And so, that logo that you see there is actually animated and can be animated and can be used in augmented reality experiences. So we're super excited about it. It really represents a lot of hard work, a lot of vision, and I couldn't be more proud of how it came out. I mean, you know, look at my background, look at my logo, and everybody at the company is super excited about it.
Absolutely. Okay. Well, let's talk about 2020. You mentioned just the success of it. I want to take you back a little bit into this time last year. You and I were having, you know, regular interviews in January and then February. And then, of course, you had lots of plans for the year and then COVID hit and the world was turned upside down. Are you proud of the way that you and your team responded and what was this pandemic and really were able to take the company to another level? I'm sure much quicker than you ever thought because of the pandemic.
Absolutely. I mean, it just goes to show you the resilience of our team, our ability to navigate turbulent waters. We started the year very excited about 2020. We actually were planning on launching our 3D ad network, coincidentally, in the Q1 of 2020, but the pandemic showed up and everybody kind of went into lockdown. And so, you know, we ended up acquiring Jalokia. As everybody knows, Jalokia was doing about $1 million in annual business. And really for the month of December, we booked $2 million. I think actually a little more than that in business just on that platform alone, which is just a testament to how far we've come. You know, when we acquired that business, it was doing, you know, like a little less than 100,000 a month. And, you know, so 2 million is like 20x that, right? We've also taken our team from a small team of entrepreneurs to 225 employees now. And within that team, we have a whole bunch of talented tech executives, which is a huge part of building. You know, how do you build a multi-billion dollar company? Well, it's all about the team. And so in 2020, Steve, we hired guys from Apple. Obviously, Harish just joined us from Microsoft. Eugen, 18-year veteran from SAP. We also hired a guy from Disney. He was previously also at SAP for 23 years. Our channel partner lead is from VMware. Our CMO, again, is from Apple and Norton. And so we have all these executives at the company. These are experienced executives that we brought on in 2020 to help us navigate the next wave of growth for NexTech. And so, you know, when I look at 2020, Steve, I think of us laying the foundation for a billion-dollar company. In 2019, we were just forming, building our tech stack, and just really getting started, just getting our legs under us. In 2020, I feel like we've really built the foundation to become a juggernaut in the industry and really become that multi-billion dollar company that we set out to build back in 2018.
Evan, besides the people that you mentioned of your hires, what do you think were the key drivers for, as you've described in the past, 2020 as a building year? So what do you think are the key drivers for the building of that year that will lead you into 2021?
So that's easy. The customers. You know, first, I mean, obviously you need customers to be able to go back to and sell more stuff to. And so in 2020, the list of customers that we landed, the brands, is kind of eye-popping. I mean, we've mentioned many times on this show the Dells, the Bell Canadas, the Teluses. We're also working with Microsoft. We're also working with IBM. We're also working with Stably, Himmel, Polycom. Everybody knows we have a $500,000 contract with Ryerson University, the Canadian Mining Institute, Restaurants Canada, which services, you know, all the 20,000 restaurants throughout Canada, Boehringer, Ingelheim, Johnson & Johnson. We're negotiating a multi-year contract with Carnegie Mellon. You know, we have a who's who list of customers, and those customers have deep pockets. These are not, you know, customers that can't afford to leg into a multi-million dollar, multi-year deal, which is what we're negotiating for right now. All these executives that we brought on, they all come from the world of enterprise sales, and they're working our customer list, obviously also new customers. We just landed Luxottica, which is a big eyeglass manufacturer. And so it's all about the customers, Steve. Without the customers, it's very hard to expand. And the customers are flocking to NexTech because we have something nobody else has. We have augmented reality integrated into our virtual experience platforms. We have augmented reality integrated into our e-commerce platforms. We have augmented reality integrated into our ad network. Nobody else has these things. And so when we're presenting, you know, these are industry veterans that we're presenting to, right? The Amazons, the Dells, the Luxotticas, the Microsofts. I mean, when we present to them, yeah, they get very excited. And these are guys that have seen it all. And they end up doing business with us because we have a very unique value proposition, a very unique product offering. And that's really what's driving this. And, you know, to be honest with all of our viewers, it wasn't really planned. I didn't, when I founded the company, it wasn't like, oh, we're going to have, you know, this incredible lineup of product that's going to blow all these big companies away. That actually wasn't what I was thinking per se. I was thinking augmented reality is going to be the next big thing. Mm-hmm. And I want to get in front of that tidal wave. And I'm going to figure it out as we go along, because I have confidence in my business sense. And so here we are, you know, that's actually turned into a reality. And as we go forward into 2021, I really couldn't be more excited.
I want to ask you about revenue in a second, because you and I just had a conversation recently about how you did in December and what you're expecting for 2021. But I just want to ask you before we get to that, are there areas that you thought could have been better as far as the company is concerned? Because you obviously highlight the good stuff, which is great. That's a company always does that. But as a CEO, you look at everything and say, you know what, we were here, but we should have been about here. Is there a certain part of the company that you'd like to see some improvement in 2021?
That's a good question. Absolutely. You know, we were building it while we were flying it.
Yeah. Right? Which is always a challenge. Yeah.
It's very, very hard to do that. And very few companies actually succeed at doing that without, you know, the engines kind of flying off. We're building it while we're flying it. We've definitely, you know, gotten our knees scraped up a bit as we're going along here. But all in all, the team has risen to every adversity. The team has risen to everything that's been thrown at us. And I would say, you know, 2020 kind of battle hardened us as a company. Like, what's gonna happen that's gonna be more challenging than a pandemic? And in the early part of the year, we were hit by, you know, a couple of short reports. I mean, seriously, what's going to be more challenging for our company in 2021 than what happened in 2020? I actually think, you know, we made it through the toughest part of our growth curve. Now it's just tacking it on and scaling the business. Like, I actually think we broke out in 2020. And that things are just going to get better and better from here.
Yeah, your bookings were very solid in the fourth quarter and in 2020. Just talk about the year that was financially and where you expect the company to be in 2021.
Sure. So, you know, we started the year, we generated $2.5 million in Q1, $3.5 million in Q2. And then we saw the liftoff from the new business that we acquired, which, you know, the virtual events business, and we reported 6.7 million in bookings for Q3 and then 7.3 million in Q4, which, you know, quarter over quarter, that's a continuing acceleration. So if you add up, you know, Q3 and Q4, you know, you end up with $15 million or 75% of our revenue in the second half of the year. So if you think about that, that's the momentum. That's the mojo. That's what's happening in our business. So the business is now growing exponentially. And I expect that, you know, 2021, we're projecting 50 to 60 million in revenue. I don't know if that's going to be a light number or not. I mean, but, you know, the business is not stopping. The business is growing very, very rapidly. And again, we're up to 225 talents at the company now. And we keep adding because the demand's there. Yeah. And so, yeah, I mean, 2020, you know, we did apply to NASDAQ after the stock went up. I just want to touch on that real quick. I don't know if you were going to bring that.
Well, we have about 1,950 questions about that specifically. So I'm going to ask you about that in the second half as well. But it's okay. I think it's a good idea to address it now, and then we can talk more after that.
Yeah. Well, we did apply to NASDAQ. Everybody knows. We've been in discussions with them. And, you know, I would like to ask everybody not to call NASDAQ. And, you know, because I do talk to them, and they're asking me if I'm giving out their name and number, because they're getting too many calls. And it's not, it's not professional for our shareholder base really to be calling them. It's, you know, it's not supposed to be that way. So what I can say is I'm in contact with them. We have a good relationship, a good understanding. And I believe that they're done with their Q&A, with their questions. We've given them all their answers. I believe that our uplisting is imminent. That's what I believe. And so, you know, I'm going to leave it at that.
Evan, was the stuff that happened, you mentioned, talked about the short selling earlier last year. Was that an effect on any of this? Is that why they were going over the company a little bit more of the fine tooth comb, just to make sure they put all their ducks in a row, is because of some of the misinformation that was being spread?
It absolutely was. It turned into, actually I was surprised, you know, because I look at these short and distort guys and I figure, you know, like NASDAQ's seen this a million times.
Yeah.
But the way it works is, I guess, you know, they're bringing you into this exclusive club. And if somebody accuses, you know, the company publicly of doing something that they feel isn't worthy of the exclusive club, then they're going to have to do their due diligence. If they didn't, if they ignored it, it would be a liability for them. So yes, because of that short and distort report earlier in the year, this uplisting did take longer, but as everybody knows, there was no smoking gun in that short and distort report. It was just a lot of innuendo and a lot of finger pointing, but there was nothing there. And I think we've shown that to our shareholders in multiple presentations that we've done, you know, line by line, point by point. And we had to do the same thing to a much lesser degree for NASDAQ. And so, yeah, there was some of that, Steve. And also, you know, they've been inundated with the SPACs. And so they kind of slow rolled it. But again, I think our approval is imminent.
Okay. Now we are going to introduce one of your new employees in just a second. I just got two more quick questions for you before we get to Harris Achi, who's going to be joining us. Second, people are asking about the NEO and the change to the NEO and whether or not you thought, they're asking about stock price compared to why it's not up a lot more since you've been on the NEO. So I'm not sure if the two translate to each other. So
yeah, a couple of things. So the NEO is a senior exchange, as everybody knows, in Canada, and we're super excited to list there. However, I don't think that things went smoothly. I mean, obviously, right? So it wasn't a smooth transition. It kind of turned into like an IPO, which I didn't realize that was the way it was going to go down. So they basically had a link up with all the different brokerage firms' feeds to get the quotes going, to get the level twos going, to get our news feed going. There's a whole bunch of stuff. I had a call with the CEO of the NEO, laid it all on the line for him, told him, you know, what was not working. And he has been front and center. He's, you know, he's taking it on personally, and he's resolving whatever issues there were. And I believe that, you know, it's just a bump in the road for us. It's unfortunate, but it's just a bump in the road. I will say though that, you know, just back to NASDAQ, we're preparing to be listed by talking to brokerage firms in the US. We're preparing to be listed by talking about getting research coverage, doing a non-deal roadshow, which is basically being introduced to institutions in the United States. As everybody knows, there's no institutions in the US in our stock. I think the Canadian market still has upside in terms of new shareholders, but we've been in the Canadian market traveling around Canada for the past 2+ years. You know, Canada is a relatively small market. Obviously the upside,
we don't think so here, but that's okay.
You know, it is, Steve, come on, you know, it's a small market, but Canada is a great market. But the US market is 10 or 20 X, Canada. And so we're focused on getting aligned with U.S. Investment bankers and their institutional customer base, and getting research, and all those things are absolutely front and center. That's what I focus a lot of my team's time that works with me in IR, and we're going to double down on that, and we expect to see results in Q1.
Like a true Canadian, I was polite though, which is nice. Okay, so let's get to your newest employee, and I'll set this up by getting you to talk about the significance of the 3D ad network, because that is what you expect to be a big revenue driver in 2021, and the gentleman that you've hired is going to be a big part of that. So just explain to everyone what the 3D network is, and then we'll bring in your employee.
Yeah, before we even get to the 3D ad network, I just want to speak real quickly about something I'm excited about. You know, we have this Airshow app that we acquired, and we're working right now on a TikTok application that will allow us to have a hologram of a person training anybody pretty much at home to be a TikTok dancer, right? And I know my 11-year-old daughter's just obsessed with that, and there's millions of those TikTokers out there. And so there's some exciting stuff happening behind the scenes with some of these apps that we've launched. Some of them we've acquired, and so we're super, super excited. Stay tuned for that. But as far as the ad network, Steve, it's a big deal. It's a very big deal. I think in the day-to-day, things kind of get lost a little bit in the shuffle, but I think it's important to kind of think of it from, big tech and following in the footsteps of big tech. So if you look at big tech and you look at, let's use Facebook, YouTube, Instagram as examples, but also Snap, right? Yeah. Snap is actually probably the closest and purest example of where we think we can go, because they have an augmented reality ad network. So, but what's the business model? The business model is get as many people onto your platform as possible, eyeballs, and then bring in an ad network. Facebook did it, magic. The stock, went through the roof once they launched their ad network. YouTube, Instagram, Snap. Snap stock is up 5x this year in the last 12 months. Because their ad network. It's not their user growth, it's their ad network. And so we, as a tech company, have an ad network. We're now launching it with Harish. And the idea is that we have platforms. We have our Inferno AR virtual experience platform, Map Dynamics. Map Dynamics probably has the most eyeballs on it. And if you think about Map Dynamics as a platform, or you think about events, well, each event has a very specific audience, right? If you're doing an event for dentists, who shows up? Everybody that's a dentist. If you do an event for nephrologists, who shows up? Nephrologists. If you're doing an event for any industry, whether it's a farmer's market type of event, you're getting a certain audience type.
Yeah.
And with those different audience types, you have segmented groups of people that can be targeted, highly targeted with ads, right? They're on our platform. So think about, Microsoft, think about Facebook, think about specifically Facebook and all their user groups. And Facebook makes their money because you could be very specific with your targeting. And so we see our ad network, which is being integrated, and I'll let Harish speak to it, with our platforms. I think we actually integrated like yesterday, because it's not so complicated. And so we see the ad networks as a huge source of revenue for us as our users of our platforms continues to go up. The ad network is going to continue to go up in terms of its value to NexTech. And then ultimately, Steve, we can open the ad network up to all the virtual event platforms and become the de facto ad network for virtual events, which is a huge industry, projected to be $400 billion over the next 5 years. So monster opportunity. We got Harish from Microsoft, who's running that division for us. And I'll leave it there.
Okay, well, let's bring him in. Harish Achi is with us, joining us from Reno, Nevada. Harish, welcome. Nice to see you. How are you?
Doing good. Thank you, Steve. Nice to see you too.
Yeah, very excited to learn a little bit more about you. So you're speaking to obviously a great many shareholders of the company. So maybe you could just do a bit of a background on yourself, Harish.
Yeah, sure. So my background, I'm a 20-year technology veteran, worked in the technology industry, most recently as Evan called out at Microsoft, leading some of their head operations teams. And so with that, and I think before that, I was in Chicago working at Motorola in the wireless industry as well. So I have a lot of the tech background and leading some of the digital transformation across companies, and specifically in the advertising businesses, and then as well as enterprise commercial businesses.
Yeah. Why did you see this opportunity with NexTech AR Solutions as one you wanted to take?
Yeah, I mean, I think, Steve, I think it's pretty, you know, from a, as Evan keeps talking about, right, then from a technology standpoint, when I look at the technology stack that NexTech has with their Inferno platform, which is used for virtual events, to their AR platform that's integrated across, the opportunity is huge in terms of how the industry is evolving. Like we all have seen and heard about the news, right, that this 10 years of digital transformation has happened in the last 10 months due to COVID and with all the virtual and everyone being in their homes, right? So that has, you know, evolved in the industry from a how we apply technology, how we think about technology. And that is what is driving this. And that's what was exciting to me when I looked at NexTech with their Inferno platform and how they are hosting the virtual events to their AR augmented reality platform and using the 3D as well, right? I think has immense potential to grow, and specifically for marketers and advertisers when they look at it, as Evan was mentioning briefly earlier, right? You have these conferences that are very specific to, let's say, an industry or professionals or very for a business segment, which will be very attractive because you have very targeted and engaged audience in those conferences, right? Mm-hmm. And has opportunity to advertise a lot more, very specific to, you know, that industry. Like as an example, I'll give, if you know that we are all virtual, let's say you have an event happening in Europe and you are an US company or a Canadian company and you want to grow in Europe, right? Previously, you would have to go there or, you know, you have to figure out the logistics and all those things, versus now it's virtual. You can use target specifically some of those events and put your product placements or advertising in there and get your audiences, you know, and which is very, as I said again, very targeted and engaged audiences that you can engage with. The way I see this platform is that's like, you know, as you can think, the growth of the user-generated content in consumer space, when you think of it, like with all the influencers and how you think about them, it's something similar. Like I feel it's a similar analogy that we can use in the B2B environment where you have these very specific audiences and specific events that can be used by the marketers and advertisers to increase their brand presence, increase their product awareness, and obviously about their business and their plans to grow in a different segments, different industries.
Harish, I'm just wondering, you know, Evan mentioned that your integration happened, I guess, yesterday or very close and will continue for the next little while. But yeah, do you see where this technology is right now at a level and where you want to grow it to another level? Like, are you always trying to R&D wise be better every day?
That's always true. Yes, Steve. Yes, definitely. Right. I think we are just starting right now, I would say. As Evan said, we are still early phases, and the potential is huge, right? And we are constantly evolving, constantly. And I think that is the beauty of the ad industry in general, right? I think you have seen, even if you look back, the growth in the ad industry from just having some standard display ads to going into more of sponsored ads to native ads to, you know, video ads. So you have seen all the evolution happening. And that's what I see, you know, the innovation is continues to grow, and how we advertise, how marketers play, you know, advertise their products or services is going to grow. And that's where we are in forefront of it, right? How can NexTech as a platform enable that, right? We are here to enable advertisers and marketers, and we'll continue to innovate. As I said, we are just starting. We are just in the beginning phases at this time, and the potential is huge.
Harish, I'm wondering, in your experience, obviously you've worked for some pretty big companies, so your experience and your knowledge is immense. I'm wanting to know if, because of what has happened with the pandemic, and even though vaccines are rolling out now, people are still leery about being in big crowds, going to places, going to events, things like that. Do you think, in your experience, that this has now shifted the way the general public thinks about advertising within something in order to, yeah, hit the people that are there, but really more hit the people that aren't there?
Yes, exactly. Yes, that's where the transformation, I think, is going to happen, right? Yes, the pandemic, everything was virtual. Yes, even with vaccines coming in, slowly, I mean, yeah, it's not going to be immediate. I think people need to get generally, there are early adopters, but there are late adopters as well, right? So it takes time for people to get comfortable again. But that's, again, another opportunity, because most of the users, consumers, businesses, everyone has experienced virtual platform now, right? And where I see this happening is kind of that hybrid environment that we are going into, where it's a combination of your digital presence and your physical presence and how you connect them. And I think that is what is going to grow even after this pandemic, right? I think, yes, you will have, we may return to physical events at some point, but the capabilities, the scope you have with a virtual event has been proven now, right? I think you can get a global audience real time. Like, you know, you can host a virtual event, which previously in the past was like not so much, because you always thought, hey, if you want to have a conference, bring people to a specific location, right? So now that has changed, right? Yes, we have experienced virtual, but we may go to physical as well, but there will always be that connection of online presence to offline presence, right? So you will connect them. So that is where I think marketers would be looking at, like, how can I target or, you know, find my audience on an online and then connect them to a physical presence as well. And that is where the innovation is going to happen. And that's how, you know, we'll be start seeing advertising industry grow into.
Evan, we'll get back to you in a second. I just got a couple more questions for Harish, because that's super interesting. Sure. One from someone who just asked a question I want to ask, because I think it's a really good question. But, you know, as I mentioned, you've been at Microsoft, been at Motorola. Do you see similarities within this new startup growing company to what you were facing at those other companies as well? I mean, they're obviously mammoth, but, you know, they had to start somewhere as well. Do you sort of get that feeling of this with NexTech?
Exactly. Yes, I do. Right. I think, every, you know, company that, you know, I worked in, yes, everyone has started somewhere, and that's where it's all about what you have as a technology stack and what you have as an offering for as a product differentiation. And that is what every company in the world has built on. Like, if you take any example of, you know, Facebook, Twitter, you know, all these, and at least I'm referencing advertising industry giants, right? So, but I think that's how I see NexTech, right? With their AR platform, the Inferno AR, and the technology that they have, and the capabilities that it opens up for marketers to look into, and how they can customer acquisitions to brand awareness. I think there is that scope, and that's where I feel like there is an, you know, exponential growth possibility within the, you know, business, specifically from an ad network perspective.
And last question is, someone had mentioned, you know, is this something that can be done like watching streaming movies or things like that? Can this type of technology, this 3D ad, where can it be transferred to any industry whatsoever? Can you use it everywhere?
You can use it everywhere, yes. Yeah, because we have video. You can do video and then a hologram within the video as well. Like, you know, we have these virtual backgrounds now, but you could do, you know, integrate that into the video as well. Some of the 3D AD AR networks. It can be used in education, right? Like a lot of online learning that is now getting to be. That's another opportunity. Retail, huge opportunity in retail, right? Like you have seen Amazon's, you know, kind of users have, I mean, we all have been experiencing, right? We all are ordering from Amazon these days, right? But, you know, that's where retail continues to grow, right? People will start experiencing more online. I think previously before the pandemic, it was like, yes, there was e-commerce, retail commerce, but you would still go into a store to physical, you know, experience the product. But now we can, with AR and 3D, we can make it the product experience also built in the e-commerce site. And that is going to be a game changer in how you experience the product online and then make the purchase, convert that into a purchase. So it's possibilities are endless, right? Retail, video, e-commerce, education, as I shared, training, enterprises as well, right? Like within the enterprise, you can build some of the, every enterprise has their own training materials and employee training, and those, that's also you can leverage, make it more interactive versus just a PowerPoint slide, right? So that is where I think I see huge opportunities in every part of the industry.
Evan, he seems to know his stuff.
Well, that's why we hired him. I mean, it's hard to communicate everything that's going on in a live stream, but suffice it to say that, you know, Harish didn't leave his 10-year secure job at Microsoft for, you know, something that he doesn't see as the next big thing. He clearly, you know, and he sits at the top of the mountain, right? So, you know, it's not like he couldn't see the lay of the land. So I would just say that, you know, we're super happy that Harish sees what we see, and even more, you know, he's able to see more because he's an expert in the industry. I'm not an expert. All I knew was that augmented reality, 3D ads, you know, absolutely. Like there's no doubt, like they're better than 2D. And when you look at the $1 trillion that's, you know, the ad dollars that are out there, there's a lot of money that's now up for grabs. And then, you know, just bringing it back to NexTech, you know, besides our existing platforms, as we mentioned earlier, all of our blue chip customers spend tens of millions of dollars on advertising. We spend $100 a month on ads. We're a little guy. So all of our customers, meaning they're buying virtual events from us today. They could be buying ads from us, 3D ads, tomorrow. And, you know, enormous opportunity to go back and sell some more of our technology to our existing customers. I do want to address Bitcoin. We never actually, we didn't get to cover that, Steve.
That's my next question, actually. I'm going to let Harish go, and then we're going to talk Bitcoin. Yes. Oh, I've got lots of questions. Don't worry.
Okay.
A lot of them. Let's do that. Harish, thank you so much. Great to meet you. Look forward to talking again in the future. Stay safe in Reno, and again, all the best to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Thanks for the opportunity. Thank you all. And as I said, yeah, I hope to come back again and share more updates on how we are driving our ad network and our growth in the ad network. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, awesome. Thanks, Harish. Appreciate it. Have a good day.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Harish Ache, obviously new with the company. Let's talk Bitcoin, because there's a lot of questions about Bitcoin. And you made a big announcement about moving into Bitcoin. And so a lot of the questions are, why Bitcoin? Why'd you do this? And others are along the line of, is it, while a company is so young, why take, you know, a risky opportunity like Bitcoin? So your thoughts.
Yeah. So look, it was risky. It is risky. Life is risky. 2020 was a risky year, right? Yeah. It's risk reward. If you don't take risk, you're not going to get the reward. Now, I personally don't see it as as big a risk as some people might see it. The rationale behind Bitcoin, it's really a multi-dimensional thinking. I mean, first of all, you know, you got to remember that I spent 30 years on Wall Street. So risk is like, you know, eating breakfast for me. It's not that big a deal. For some people, it's a big deal, but not so much for me. When I look at Bitcoin, I would never have put it into our treasury in 2017. And the reason was, is that, you know, it was a bubble. It was, it was literally just, you know, very speculative, too speculative for us as a small startup. But 2020 is a different time, different year. Major institutional investors, Guggenheim put $500 million in, Mass Mutual put in $100 million. You have some of the titans of the hedge fund industry, Stanley Druckenmiller, and many, many others that have invested a small portion of their fund into Bitcoin. But the backdrop, like what's making them do that is, you know, we're printing trillions of dollars every year. And then, you know, the pandemic accelerated the printing of money. And when you have a supply demand imbalance where there's all, you know, look at the dollar keeps on getting debased. At the end of the day, my job is to, you know, protect our treasury. And I have a fiduciary responsibility to shareholders. I'm the largest shareholder, as I've mentioned many times. And so yeah. I looked at Bitcoin and I said, okay, I'd love to invest in it, but I really couldn't figure out, you know, whether it was something that we could or couldn't do as a public company until I saw MicroStrategy buy $1 billion worth of Bitcoin. They're listed on NASDAQ. And the stock, you know, reacted very favorably. People liked it. I mean, it, you know, it's kind of become a Bitcoin play. And then I looked and there were like 20, 30 other companies. Square bought Bitcoin for their treasury. PayPal is now taking Bitcoin. And so those things are confirmations to me that Bitcoin is here to stay. It's not going back down to, you know, zero. That Bitcoin actually, because of the supply-demand imbalance, is going to go up in value. And so we're already up in, I don't know if it's been 30 days, we're already sitting, it's not been 30, it's two weeks, and we're sitting on over a seven-figure gain in our treasury. Now, that's money that showed up. I didn't have to sell anything. I didn't have to raise any money. I didn't have to sell any stock. I didn't have to sell any products. It's just increasing our treasury's value. I want everybody that's an investor in NexTech to imagine that that 4 million turns into 10, 12, 15 million. Well, that's like manna from heaven. You know, that's right. Where all of a sudden now our treasury is growing organically. I mean, obviously there is some risk here, but I think we saw last week the stock, Bitcoin kind of went through a mini collapse, right? It went from like, it went down like $10,000, right? And yeah, everybody kind of like, you know, got a little bit, let's say scared. I actually wasn't. I was thinking of buying more, but I knew that might, you know, because of all the feedback from shareholders, I was like, you know what, we're good. So we didn't buy any more at 30,000 or whatever it was. Now it's back to almost 40. And that shows you the resilience. That shows you that there's buying on the dips. And so I feel confident with Bitcoin. Okay. Look, at some point, we're going to be shaving it off. At some point, we'll probably sell some off. We use it like cash. Okay. We use it like cash. So it's cash equivalent to us, and our cash value is going up with Bitcoin going up. And again, we're up over $1 million in just a few short weeks as of today. So it is what it is. Everybody's got an opinion. We do own some Bitcoin.
Let's get in some questions as we've got about 15 minutes left. So someone wants to, Malcolm actually asked about advising on the progress in South Korea and Asia overall. Give everyone an update on what's going on there.
So it's actually going really, really well. We have lots of contracts, lots of business that's swirling around there. As everybody knows, we've announced COEX. I think there's multiple six-figure deals there. We're also in discussions with Reed China, which is really the biggest trade show organizer in the Asia Pacific region. We have a long list of customers, and we will be sharing more information on that as it develops. I will say that the opportunity there is enormous and that the demand is strong. We have a team now in place from Oracle, the sales force and support team comes from big tech, Oracle, IBM, SAP again. We love the SAPers and IBM we mentioned already. Motorola. So there's lots of people from Techland that's helping support, and they all have a Rolodex. And so we're excited about the Asia Pacific region, and we think it's going to be a huge contributor to our business going forward.
And will the 3D ad network be part of that as well?
Absolutely. Absolutely. The 3D ad network is for our global sales force. So it's the EMEA region, North America, Asia Pacific. As everybody knows, we are global.
Yeah. Someone has a really interesting question here that I had actually forgotten that you and I talked about a while ago. And that is that sort of augmented reality do-it-yourself that we talked about. Where's that at? And this person wants to know if the way the world is right now and all these people work from home, this sounds to me like it'd be a great opportunity to do that do-it-yourself type stack deck stuff.
Yeah, the do-it-yourself is what we just talked about with TikTok. The TikTok app will have the do-it-yourself, turn yourself into a hologram, having some of the social media stars turn themselves into holograms, and then, you know, kind of have a training session for TikTok where, you know, it's a half screen hologram of a TikTok, expert dancer,
yeah,
or influencer, right? Yeah. And then you have the other person on the side. And so there's definitely a large opportunity there to use our self-serve platform. And then, you know, we also have AR Ties 360, which is a self-serve creation app for the e-com industry. There's lots of upside to having a self-serve, no-touch augmented reality platform, which we continue to build. And, you know, as Harish said, you know, technology is constantly being innovated and built on for NexTech. Like, we just keep on pushing harder and harder at more and more innovative use cases for augmented reality.
Yeah, I'm on TikTok, and right now I have about, I think it's 3 dog videos, and that's about it so far. So I'm still working on it, slowly. All right, let's talk about PR and marketing, specifically around Genie in a Bottle. This person, Patrick, says in his email that he thinks this is a real game changer, not just for NexTech, but for the industry in general. And he wants to know if conversations are being had with Big Pharma about trying to white label this technology for them.
Yes, the answer is yes. We are having conversations with Big Pharma about white labeling. We've already done some demos for them. They loved it. And we're actually super, super excited about it and feel the same way, that it's a total game-changing technology. We've set up a whole green screen studio in California to be able to handle the demand in the market. Obviously, it's the early days, so, you know, we're building the back end platform. The technology is there, but it has to also be somewhat self-serve for it to really grow exponentially. And so that is something that we expect to be a big driver in 2021.
Okay. Got an email from Stockholm, Sweden, wanting to know a bit more about Amazon and what's going on with Amazon.
So Amazon's one of our customers and, one of our paying customers. And I can't really speak to it beyond that because they have us under a very tight non-disclosure agreement. So other than the fact that we're working with them and continuing to build our relationship with them, you know, can't really go too much beyond that.
Okay, fair enough. Obviously, we've answered the questions about the NEO, the NASDAQ. There's quite a few questions that came in asking about why not go to the New York Stock Exchange then if the NASDAQ isn't working?
We are talking to the New York Stock Exchange. I guess what it comes down to is I feel like the, you know, NASDAQ is so imminent. It's like, how much do I want to spend? How much time do I want to spend on the NYSE application? It's kind of like that. I guess there is a point where I think it's go time with NYSE versus just continuing to wait for NASDAQ. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm close.
Okay. Someone wants to know about institutional investors. And is it a wait till we get to the NASDAQ before you see them jumping on board? Is there has to be a process involved in it? Because this person said he sees a lot of those investors sort of snooping around.
Yeah. So yes and no. So as I mentioned earlier, we're talking to investment banking firms in the US. We have multiple conversations going on. And so there's the opportunity for, you know, these non-deal roadshows where you're presenting, I'll be presenting to institutional money managers. We also have our own in-house IR. We're doing an outreach to be able to present. So we can present to institutional money managers because we're on the NEO exchange, which is a senior exchange. I believe that opens the door for them to be able to buy us. At least on the Canadian market. I'm not sure if they would be able to do it in the US market, but because our stock trades cross-border, it shouldn't be a big deal. But there's no doubt that NASDAQ opens the floodgates. So, you know, maybe there's a trickle that we're on the NEO. At least there is a trickle on the CSE. You wouldn't even have that. But once we get on NASDAQ, the floodgates open and it's game on for institutions. And so obviously that's why we've applied to NASDAQ, and that's why everybody's so anxious for us to get onto NASDAQ.
Yeah, we get. Absolutely. Yeah. We have another question here wanting to know about, you mentioned that there's been a lot of bookings with the company. When does that actually turn into paid revenue? And do you think the company will be profitable this year?
So typically with bookings, things get paid within 90 days. So we don't have a lot of bookings that go out beyond that. There are some, but mostly it's, you know, 60 to 90 days. And the way we structure it is it's 50% down, 50% prior to going live. So, you know, that's kind of our business model. As far as, you know, the annual licenses, there will be some seven-figure deals that we're chasing right now in Q1 that will be multi-year deals where they pay monthly. So if you could imagine a $4 million deal over a period of 3 years, you know, that would be 100 and something thousand a month, right? And so, you know, that's good business for us. And we'll sign those deals every day of the week because it gives some visibility. But in general, our transactions are paid within 90 days.
Okay. We had a lot of questions. This is interesting about understanding what you're doing as far as augmented reality is concerned and video and all that, but wondering if there's anything on the horizon as far as audio is concerned. And the main reason is we got about 9 questions about podcasting and how popular that's getting. Is there something within NexTech that would enhance podcasting?
Not that I could think of, Steve, because
I know that's audio. A tough one for me too. Yeah,
it's audio. It's an audio kind of thing.
But let me say this, if you are, you know, on your computer and you have your podcast up, I mean, there could be QR codes, I guess, where there's ad revenue coming from it. I guess that's one way to look at it.
Yeah, I would say that's not the low-hanging fruit. I would say that, you know, that most people are listening to podcasts in their car. Scanning the QR code would be no. Yeah. And so I would say podcasts are not really the market for us.
Okay. There's a lot of questions about joint ventures in 2021. Are you discussing potential joint ventures of your technology with someone else's technology?
Absolutely. We're in discussions with Snap. We're in discussions. Microsoft, we announced that we're partners with. That's going to go to the next level, I think, in this month, January. And so Microsoft's going to start selling our tech. So there's lots of partnership opportunities for sure within Techland. Yeah. And we have, you know, tons of channel partners that we're talking to where, you know, they're basically resellers. We expect that to be a big part of our business in 2020 for sure.
Okay. Last two questions here. Someone wants to know about the Airshow app. Are you still targeting live music events such as Live Nation? Any updates would be appreciated on Airshow.
Yes, we are. It's tricky because you have so many contracts that an artist has with their producer, their manager, their label. There's a lot of let's say hands in the pie. Yeah,
very much so.
Yeah. And so it's a tricky business. But yeah, we're in discussions with different artists. But I think, you know, the biggest opportunity for us really is to use it in like a TikTok type of environment where you don't have that same issue.
Right. Last question is esports. Is that something that NexTech's technology could enhance in esports? And is there any conversations about that this year, do you think?
I mean, I know a guy in the esports space that contacted me a little while back, and he wanted to kind of partner with us. I do have to follow up with him, so stay tuned.
Okay. Evan, just got a couple of minutes left here. I just want to give you an opportunity just for some final thoughts about what's expected in 2021 and what investors should look forward to for NexTech.
Sure. So, you know, I think the investors at this point that have been buying our stock recently are a bit frustrated with the lack of upside movement. And I just want to remind the investors that this has happened numerous times in the past since we've been a public company. For really all of 2019, the stock sat very frustratingly in a pretty tight trading range. And no matter what good news came out, the stock would go up and then it would sell off. And that happened until it didn't happen. And when, you know, it didn't happen, the stock went up 300%. And then, you know, it was stuck in another range for a period of 6 months. And then that didn't happen where the stock broke out and went up 300% and hit 10. And now the stock's been sitting in a range and it's kind of frustrating to me, to you. But my feeling is that at the end of the day, and, you know, Warren Buffett says it best, in the short term, the stock and stock markets are a voting machine, but in the long term, it's a weighing machine. You weigh in, and the weighing in is how much revenue, what's your profitability, how's your business? And, you know, our business is better than ever. It gets stronger every single day. We're signing up customers every day, every other day. And these are big names. We're hiring more talents. And so in my opinion, we're undervalued as a public company right now because we don't have the institutions supporting the stock. You have a lot of retail investors that are trading off of, you know, either stock charts or chat rooms or things that are kind of like neither here nor there. Far as the business goes. And so I would just say that, you know, for me, I am a long-term investor. I continue to buy stock in my company. I continue to write checks, money from my pocket going into the company's treasury. And I'm going to continue to do that. I believe that we're in the very, very early days of our company's trajectory as a public company. And I believe that the big upside is still ahead of us as the institutional sponsorship and ownership of our shares has not happened yet. That's still ahead of us. And when that happens, it will be a completely different stock and a completely different story. But until that happens, we have to, you know, kind of deal with the day-to-day, what gets said in chat rooms, stock charts, people selling, you know, and that's kind of it. I mean, there's a lot of, I get a lot of emails. I communicate with our investors. I know that's what's on their minds. The catalyst is the business is getting stronger and stronger. And in my opinion, it's only a matter of time. Nobody can predict exactly when, but if you look at our history, the history, I think, speaks to what you can expect from our stock in the future. Okay. That's all with that, Steve.
All right, Evan Gappelberg, thank you so much. Great to see you again. And I know we'll be talking again real soon. So have a great day and have a happy new year.
Thanks, Steve.
Appreciate it. All right, there's Evan Gappelberg, the CEO of NexTech AR Solutions. And once again, we want to thank you as well for joining us for another Proactive live stream from the Worldwide Broadcast Center in Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. I'm Steve Darling. Have a great day.